Czemu, kurwa? Bo, ej, wiecie co? Ja bym chciał puścić jedną rzecz. Czy jest osobno soundtrack z tego? Z Cyberpunka? W sensie ta piosenka.
Wróciłem.
O, Bullets by Archive. Ja chcę to puścić, niech to gra. Ups, reklama. Zaraz. Puśćmy sobie ten soundtrack z tego. I czytajmy dalej. Teraz będzie coś o pojazdach. Nie jest do końca pewne, jak duże jest Night City, a szkoda. Ej, właśnie, ej, to jest ciekawe, może będziemy mieli swojego kompana AI, to było spoko. Wiesz, wsiadasz do samochodu, hello, i wiesz, tylko jakiś taki samochód z taką swoją własną osobowością, tak?
Taki, jak to było widzieliśmy zajebiste. W filmach wiele razy, to jest super motyw.
A to by było zajebiste, jak coś takiego zrobili. Tak, na pewno, znaczy, bo tu coś było powiedziane, że będzie dużo poruszania się wertykalnie, także tutaj na pewno samochody nie będą jakieś taką, nie będzie takich wielkich przestrzeni do jeżdżenia samochodami, przynajmniej tak mi się wydaje. Cyberpunk ma więcej cywilów niż w większości innych gier. Coś czuję, że to może być liczba porównywalna z Assassin's Creed Unity. Tak mi się wydaje. Przyciszę to trochę, bo aż siebie za bardzo nie słyszę. No, podobno writing i voice acting jest superb, jak
no
się jakoś...
Także,
czekaj się, ale dlaczego może się spodziewać po redak? Przyznajmy to. The dialogue options also seem they like they had a really weight to them. At one point, a deal gone south made...
Czyli gone wrong, inaczej.
Aha, dobra. Czyli tak, została zhakowana V i linia została... Coś jak jakby jakiś wykrywacz tła... kłamstw. The player could still lie. For her partner. Aha, czy jeszcze jakiś partner, okej. Okay. Może trailer teraz pokazuje Cyberpunka?
Nie, Lego, super.
Ale czat jest po prostu oszalały, że nie
i
ma.
Dobrze.
Aha, czyli mogliśmy albo skłamać, pewnie albo powiedzieć prawdę, albo po prostu wziąć pistolet i zacząć strzelać. Okej. Okay.
Tak, teraz drugie pytanie. Póki co, na jakie gry najbardziej czekasz w tym roku?
Czytamy Cyberpunka, zamknij mordę!
Widzicie, jak to kurwa jest tym człowiekiem? Nie da się. Nie ma.
These dialogues options don't feel as stationary as The Witcher 3. Znaczy, bo wiecie, wybory Wiedźminie jednak były podyktowane tym, jaki Geralt był w książce, tak? More casual dialogue choices would pop up while walking around with the NPC partner. Ja jestem ciekawy, kim jest ten partner.
Ale partnerzy,
wyborni. Ale to fajnie może być, że idziesz sobie z pierwszej osoby i gadasz z kimś, masz opcję. Jestem ciekawy, jak wygląda wybieranie opcji. They happened to say that right after we carried a naked woman, she had rescued for a job. Czekajcie, bo ja czegoś nie rozumiem. Barcie, pomóż.
Co?
Ten akapit. Ten, co mam na nim kursor.
Czyli they have to odciąć, tak?
A, dobra, już nieważne, dobra, już wiem. Czekajcie, wiesz co, ta muzyka aż mnie zagłusza, muszę ją przyciszyć bardzo. Ja nie słyszę nic na słuchawkach, w sumie tak sobie przyciszę też. Czyli tak, no, czyli, bo pewnie był ktoś, kto gadał z tego projektu o tym, przynajmniej na to by wychodziło. Czyli tak, Vi wyniosła nagą kobietę, kiedy miała ją chyba uratować z budynku, tak mi się wydaje. I podczas cutscenki widzieliśmy ją budzącą się rano, tylko w bieliźnie. And you can read between the lines for yourself, but it's not like it's called romance. Options will be in Cyberpunk 2. No, kto by się tego kurwa spodziewał? Nie, naprawdę?
Nie.
Będą opcje romansowe w Cyberpunku, co?
No, nie.
A handful of cutscenes were the only time Cyberpunk left first person. No i poza drivingiem...
Głupi Yubi, jeszcze dodam, że głupi Ubisoft nie chciał dać Stenseksu do Assassin'a Nowego. Bo przynajmniej jeszcze nic z tym nie wiadomo, ani nie ma tego jeszcze w debie. Tam się jest jeden pełny romans. Nie ma Stenseksu. Przykro, przykro.
Tak, o, to jest bardzo dobre zdanie. Cyberpunk to nie... To na pewno nie jest Cyberpunk
tak,
Witcher.
To jest kurwa właściwie jest to pewno. Jak na ten IGN weź to spójrz.
Jak ten czat zapierdala, to musi być teraz tyle, no 12 tysięcy osób to ogląda i wszyscy chcą cyberpunka i kurwa i nie ma cyberpunka.
Tylko widzę kurwa cyberpunk w każdym jednym zdaniu i ja nie wiem.
No najważniejsze dla mnie, już nawet walić ten otwarty świat, to jaka to tam będzie historia, to będzie i tak najważniejsze.
Green.
Może coś jeszcze napisali? Zobaczmy IGN-a.
A może nie? Może pogadajmy o czymś innym?
Nie! Dzisiaj jest cyberpunk. Nawet jest tytuł, że panel o cyberpunku.
Kurwa, są inne bardzo fajne rzeczy. W tym
ale
roku, a nie kurwa za 3 lata, czy tam za inne.
Trudno.
Ja pierdolę. Nie, jeszcze kilka rzeczy się pewnie zmieni jeszcze 5 razy.
Zamknij mordę, dzisiaj jest wszystko o cyberpunku.
Yes.
Więc aż dopisze IGN, bo chyba IGN to jest takie najlepsze źródło informacji. Tylko angielski IGN. Najlepiej. Jeżeli o 23, o północy, przepraszam, to już w ogóle północ jakoś to strasznie szybko leci i nie będzie cyberpunka, to kogoś zapierdolimy chyba. Wait, ja zobaczę co na Discordzie piszą, także chwilę kamerki nie będzie. Póki co, zobaczmy general chat.
We are going to
tu jest dużo tych wiadomości. To ciekawe, bo tu pewnie też ludzie się prują. No tak, ale to już było. To przecież czytaliśmy.
Chyba tak, jak bardzo z cyberpunka, czy cokolwiek się nie podoba, póki co. Z informacji, które wyciekły.
Nie wiem, czy ciężko mi powiedzieć. Że też no, ciężko jest powiedzieć, bo tylko tak naprawdę poznaliśmy odczucia kogoś, tak?
Ja mogę tylko stwierdzić, że mi się za bardzo póki co nie podoba perspektywa z pierwszej osoby. Wolałbym trzecią. Mimo wszystko.
Aha, sorry everybody trying to figure out what happened to the cyberpunk interview.
Co, kurwa, zgubili?
Zgubili, kurwa!
Jak to? Co, ta płytka im się, kurwa, zapomniała?
No, zgubili wywiad z ludźmi z CD Projektem.
No, może hakowali jak konferencję Microsoftu, no.
No, zgubili sobie, zgubili.
Bo wiesz, tak naprawdę Cyberpunk wyjdzie za 5 lat, tylko nie usunęli konferencję i pokazali trailer teraz.
O co chodzi? Oj, to jest dzień pisze. Cyberpunk X Next! Wow!
Dobra,
w końcu,
wow,
kurwa,
dobra,
go! Clancy's in there, as Lex. Okay. Masakra. Greg Miller, is he gonna be in the
game? He is. Who's can't tell who he is. Oh, come on, can't we scoop kind of funny? Or whatever he's doing?
I don't know what, is he still doing that?
I don't know what he's, Greg Miller's doing. Yeah. I don't know, but that's good. Anybody else you can tease? Without telling us who they're playing?
Or locations, even? Something?
Yeah, I would really love to, but I think when people see our list of voice actors, I promise you, it's the best cast list I've ever worked with. It's amazing. The Batman is the Batman. The Joker is the Joker, and it continue as that goes. That's all I'll say.
Oh boy.
So.
Okay, well that's extremely promising. Is there anything else you want to touch on while
Yeah, for me it's just a case of I think you know. October's are going to be a really busy month this year for games, I know. I'm staying tuned to everything at E3, it's so exciting. But LEGO DC Supervillains is out in October. People should be going out and pre-ordering it, because if they do, they get an amazing season pass, which is incredible and exciting and has Titans content that's amazing. And as well as that, there's a really cool Lex minifig in a Superman power suit.
Nice. And that is worldwide October 19th on... Anything you can play games on in this day and age.
Switch, PS4, Xbox One, PC.
Beautiful. Well, thank
Great.
You so much.
Can't wait for it.
Yeah. No, thank you. Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Back to you guys.
Thanks, Max. Now sit tight, because IGN Live at E3 2018 will be back with Cyberpunk 2077.
Miał być godzinę temu, panie prowadzący, kurwa.
Yeah.
Ale jest, w końcu, na co wszyscy czekają, bo... Dobrą jarę.
Before you find IGN's awesome content anywhere else online, you'll find it right at home on IGN.com. With IGN First, you'll get a sneak peek at never-before-seen gameplay, exclusive insights from developers, and a whole lot more. NVC Live brings you IGN's Nintendo podcast up close and personal. Engage with other viewers, ask our NVC hosts your burning questions, and become a part of the show. Don't miss out. Find everything first on IGN.com.
If you're not following IGN on social media, what are you waiting for? We're bringing the memes, gameplay, custom original content, the best user-generated videos and art, and a whole lot more. Be part of the conversation throughout the year. Follow IGN on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
The IGN app is the best way to stay up to the minute on what you love. No matter what you play, create the custom feed and filter what you want to watch. Live streams have never been easier to
play. With the floating video player on iOS, okay.
Watching the live stream as you read other news. World premiere trailers and the biggest games. Download the IGN app from the iOS or Android stores now. Sign up for notifications and we'll alert you the second news breaks. Not only is IGN the world's biggest...
No i w życiu tego nie pokażę, no będą spamić jakimiś swoimi reklamami, Boże. Jestem ciekawy, co powiedzą, mam nadzieję, że nie to samo. Jeżeli coś pokażę, to będzie zajebiście. IGN brings you all the coverage you need, no matter where you are. Whether you're on IGN.com, the IGN app, YouTube, Facebook, or Snapchat, we've always got you covered. IGN, the number one source for all games and entertainment fans worldwide.
IGN Live at E3 2018 is presented by Marvel Studios' Ant-Man and the Wasp in theaters July 6.
Welcome back to IGN Live at E3 2018, your source for all the big games, breaking news, and live demos coming out of the show. Let's check in with Max Scoville over at the Convention Center with Cyberpunk 2077.
And I am here with Tom from IGN and Peter from CD Projekt Red. Tom and I just got a chance to check out Cyberpunk, and this is one of the biggest games of the show. You made an incredible reveal at the tail end of Microsoft's conference, and people were like, where's the gameplay? And we got to see it behind closed doors. Tom, start asking questions. There's so much to cover here.
I mean, let's start with the big one, which is that you guys showed off that it's a first-person RPG. It's exactly. not going to be third-person like The Witcher 3.
Yeah, exactly. So I would like to emphasize that it plays in first-person perspective. It's really up close and personal because all of the cool details we want to show you, we've been thinking about this a lot, and they really work well when you're like really close to the action, so you can explore all the visceral details of what the lore has to offer.
But it's also there's also driving. There are vehicles in here, which can be controlled in third person.
Exactly.
And there are cinematic cutscenes where you see your character from a third person.
Exactly.
There's a lot going on here. Also, there's character creation.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a huge difference from one of the previous games that we created. You might remember the name. And like to really own this adventure, I don't think it would have been a wise choice to go with like a preset character, especially since the lore of the game goes about like self-modifications, like upgrades, installing cyberware, and having like an almost complete total freedom of becoming who you are. And that's kind of what the game is about, like becoming who you are, maintaining this control, trying to dodge and fight all the systems who are trying to like fit you into a certain bracket.
And that kind of emphasis on player choice was really, really clear in this demo. But also, the character you are playing has a name. The name is V, right? Exactly. And they are kind of a bespoke character within this world that's, you know, you make them who you want, but they'll have a story that they go through that is like a more traditional RPG in that sense.
So this is not the first time it happens in the gaming industry, and it's mostly because of narrative reasons. Like, we figured that the narratives, the spoken dialogue, can happen more efficiently, speaking to the player and the character at the same time if we maintain a name character, but we still maintain that the name we are using leaves room for you to be in that character. As you remember, the character was referred to as V, right?
Right.
So you get to be the remaining name of the character that you get to establish throughout the whole thing, and the appearance of the character is completely up to you.
So one thing I love is that we've gotten so accustomed to video games having a HUD, which is, you know, it can take you out of the experience. In this case, it actually adds to the experience and is sort of a mechanic because you have cybernetic implants, so being able to identify characters or see how many bullets are in your gun are in fact upgrades to your character. Speak a little bit about that, please.
Exactly. So with the previous game, we wanted to make sure that less is actually more. And this particular case, we could go a little more nuts in this regard, because seeing all sorts of bits of useful information displayed on your screen is very much part of the lore. And you can acquire that. And you can implement that as like the part of the lore and your systems that you're implementing in yourself. But we still very much like to focus on the game happening in the game. And we don't like to force information down your throat. As in, like, this is what you need to pay attention to. You're not going to approach a mission marker, but you're going to go to places. So we would like to focus on the game being, like, pretty straightforward about its content and use the least possible amount of digital help to get you immersed as much as you can.
Yeah, there was that great scene in the demo we saw where the character kind of gets one of their eyes replaced with an optical sensor or scanner eye, and you see the eye getting implanted from the perspective of this new eye. It's very, very weird.
That's an opportunity this whole lore has to offer. Like,
right.
I don't think any other like fantasy environment lets you observe yourself from the outside like in such a visceral way.
But despite that, it didn't feel overly gruesome or grim. Like, the difference in tone from the first trailer you guys showed 6 years ago to this newest one is pretty stark. Can you talk a little bit about, it seems like lighter, it seems sunnier literally, but also just a little bit kind of more lighthearted in some of its presentation?
There's still, like, very mature stuff going on in the demonstration and in the trailer as well. Like, of course, like, toned a little down. This is actually something we've been maintaining as a consistent thing. So there's no self-gratuitous content in the game. There wasn't any in The Witcher, and there's no none of that in Cyberpunk. Like, what we use, what we show to you, all has a purpose, all has a function to set a mood, to set set goals, introduce characters, feelings, emotions. Everything has a purpose, and everything we do happens for a reason.
Can you speak a little bit about the scale of the world? Because you stress the fact that it is a seamless open world, and it sounds like a bottomless experience.
Exactly. So the size of the world will be compared, of course, and people will ask us about how big is the game world. And it's a really tricky question. It's actually like, first and foremost, it's very hard to measure because The Witcher was like pretty flat. It's like landscapes, mountains, but everything is like can be observed top down, right? And Cyberpunk, Night City, is very vertical. So there's a lot of vertical possibility to introduce depth to your exploration. So size-wise, I would like to repeat myself to about like what I said a couple of years earlier when we were talking about the philosophy of how we are building the world of The Witcher. It shouldn't be big, it should be enough. Mm-hmm. It should be able to house your adventure, like give home to your adventures. And when you're roaming the streets, driving, walking around, exploring the deepest gutters or the highest skyscrapers, you should never feel like that it's lacking. It should always be there for whatever you want to do.
So also, let's talk about that location a little bit. Night City is where it's set, this kind of fictional city in between San Francisco and L.A., is that right?
The official name of the location, and I practiced this so hard to memorize it, is the Free State of North California. It's okay. On the coast.
Okay. And you mentioned in the demo that this world is going to change depending on your actions and depending on choices you make as you go. Can you just talk a little bit about that?
So this is still very much a key thing. And since the world offers so many opportunities to change things in yourself and in your environment, the original values of choice and consequence coming from our previous games like is more prominent than ever. You'll have plenty of opportunities, as you saw probably on the game demo, like several times over during a single quest, you can change your mind or alter your approach, how you want to do this. Like initially, you will be introduced to a quest that is literally just talking to someone and the firefight can break out. Or if you have the necessary skills, abilities, or street cred, then you can do something completely different and end up with a result that maybe you were not even expecting.
That's something I wanted to touch on, is it seems like you're really breaking down the barrier between sort of narrative gameplay and more interactive gameplay. Like, it doesn't feel like dropping into, like, a conversation moment. At several points during our demo, the character would have, like, a gun pointed at them, and you had dialogue options, but there was also the option to just grab the gun and start shooting. Can you speak a little bit about how constructing that works?
Yeah, so what we have is a synergy of both. We are still putting a lot of effort into having like a really, really strong narrative, of course. Storytelling is our bread and butter. I think we can say that we do that with a lot of experience behind our back. So we would like to maintain this. However, we would also like to give you an opportunity to interact with this. And we want to tell stories that are your stories, that are a result of your actions, because it's really interesting. Everything that happens in the world, especially in the world in Cyberpunk, is a result of communication, interaction, like in a violent way or non-violent way. And there's so many things to explore about that. And it's actually a lot of fun discovering all our possibilities when it comes to establishing what the story will be. Because some things are set in stone. There are some guidelines we're heading over, but a lot of things we're still discovering. And it's a super exciting journey to find out like what we can do, what we can let players do, how convenient it is for them to explore all the opportunities that we offer to them. And it changes with like basically every single person that gets to interact with this system.
And we talked about this a little bit right before we came on stage, but there's already a little bit of a conversation going on right now about like people are a little bit confused or bummed or whatever the word might be about it being a first-person game. Why did you guys go that way, and like, how do you feel about people kind of like disappointed that it's not just like The Witcher?
First and foremost, I really, really enjoy all the attention this subject is getting because it's important. This has been an educated decision, and again, the first-person point of view is there so you can see things happening up close. And you can really interact in a visceral manner with the game world. And it worked out well during our exploration of the genre. Third person is good with games like The Witcher, where you have a lot of motion and movement around you. But when all the things happen to you, from you, within you, first person point of view, I think, is an appropriate decision to take.
Also, with all the augmentations, it makes
especially
a ton of sense.
With those.
One thing I'm curious about, Geralt, obviously a very nomadic character, wanders all over the place. In this case, we're shown V's apartment, or sort of home base. Can you speak a little bit about the role that plays in the game?
So V's apartment will be a standard thing, as in like you can own your apartment and there's a chance to own multiple. This is where you basically go home to and regroup. You're going to store your equipment there in a cool fashion, like of course style over substance. So we want to showcase your collection of clothes maybe, or your weapons. There's going to be a gear room, as you saw, and it's going to give you an opportunity to check out all the cool things that you have in like a very, very stylish fashion. So this is also to increase the feeling of ownership of the game, because one of the most important things the protagonist has is to control who she is, and you are basically what you own. And what greater way to express this than through the apartment you have?
So another thing, I mentioned this, the sort of the breaking between more systematic things and then gameplay things. We saw a part equipping a jacket was done at the apartment. Can you change things from just a menu in the game, or do you have to be at your apartment to re-equip items?
That was partially to be able to show you how cool the things look in a wardrobe, right? So we have to have that. But of course, equipping items is not a location dependency. Of course, sometimes you need to fight for something, go there.
Szczerze, szkoda. Wolałbym, żeby to było zachowane realistycznie i naprawdę trzeba by zmieniać jak wyglądać w barze.
I am dying to see this demo all over again.
Especially since you missed the ending.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, back to you guys.
Now be sure to throw on your mirror shades, because when we get back, we've got another colorful look at Cyberpunk 2077.
To jeszcze nie koniec. Ej, wait. Ej, boy. Ej, pewnie będzie ten drugi gościu. Kurczę. Jak ja słucham o tej grze, ja sobie tak wyobrażam, że po prostu... I ta pierwsza właśnie pierwsza osoba, mi to tak pasuje po prostu. Oh. Po prostu po tym, jak gościu odpowiadał, ja mam nadzieję, że ja sobie tej gry... Bo jeżeli ta gra nie będzie zgodna z moimi aktualnymi wyobrażeniami, to będę mocno zawiedziony, ale po prostu...
Tego ja nie myślę nic, tego się nie mogę się skupić.
Po tym, co ten gość teraz opowiadał, kurczę, jeżeli to robi CD Projekt, to po prostu może być tak immersyjne, to jak będzie drugie kurwa życie w tym świecie. Właśnie przez tą pierwszą osobę, przez te wszczepy. Jeżeli naprawdę, powiedzmy, na początku jedyne, co będziemy widzieć w grze, to jest świat z oczu bohatera. I nawet można by wytłumaczyć w cutscenach trzecią osobę tym, że mamy jakiś wszczep, który pozwala nam widzieć, albo mam latającą kamerę wokół siebie. Nie wiem, kurwa no. One source for all games and entertainment fans worldwide. Po prostu hype is real.
Spider-Man.
Zamknij mordę. Jezus Maria. Wiecie co? Ja chcę pracować w IGN, ja też chcę widzieć live demo Cyberpunka tak ze 2 lata przed wszystkimi innymi. Mech. Wow. Jezus Maria, jeżeli dam radę zrobić taki zbiór informacji o Cyberpunku, jakie wiem, jakie oni tu przedstawili, będę się naprawdę zadowolony. Chociażby dla siebie, żebym wiedział, jaką w momencie zapowiedzi miałem, jakie miałem wyobrażenie tej gry. I jak bardzo ono się pokryje z tym, co będą zapowiadać później, i jak już to w końcu wyjdzie. Jeżeli pokażą tego jeszcze więcej teraz, a później jeszcze więcej, to już w ogóle. Może mam nadzieję, że wspomnią coś o tym, o relacjach z postaciami, o tych romansach, bo to też mnie interesuje. Full nudity, co mnie? Rule 34, ups. At E3 2018 is presented by Marvel Studios. I'm so hyped. Ant-Man and the Wasp right now. In theaters July
6. Ja się nie hypuję, mówię. Ja się boję.
A się hypujesz za mocno. Dobra, oglądajmy.
Welcome back to IGN Live at E3 2018, your front row seat to the big show. Now, let's dive a little deeper into CD Projekt Red's Cyberpunk and see why it's getting some of the biggest buzz at the show. After 5 long years of waiting, we've finally gotten a closer look at Cyberpunk 2077, CD Projekt Red's massive open-world RPG follow-up based on the classic pen-and-paper RPG Cyberpunk 2020, created by Mike Pondsmith in 1988. At a glance, this might seem like your usual all-sizzle, no-stake E3 trailer, but there's a lot to take away. Here's what we noticed. If we missed anything, be sure to let us know in the comments. The trailer opens up on a transit map of Night City, where Cyberpunk is set.
The narrator describes it as being the worst place to live in America. Luckily, it's a fictional city in California, located between San Francisco and LA. There's a lot to take in, but one name that jumps out is Orbital Airspace Center, which would suggest that this game might not only be set on Earth. Maybe we'll get to visit some orbital colonies too. The two ruffians hassling the salaryman could very well be Rocker Boys, one of the original roles playable in the pen and paper RPG. In any case, street gangs play a large part in Night City. While Cyberpunk 2077 is leaning very heavily into the retro-futuristic 80s aesthetic of the original RPG, it's been infused with real-life technological advances like smartphones, which will undoubtedly play a role in the game alongside all the fictional tech like cybernetic enhancements. Megacorporations are also a main theme in Cyberpunk, and we can see the name Arasaka on one building, which is a private security firm specializing in paramilitary contracting. It's very likely players will either be working for them or against them. Presumably, players won't be limited to taking the train, and the trailer emphasizes vehicles, both on the ground and in the air. We can see Night City Police Department on the right side of this plaza. Depending on how they handle character creation, cop is one of the original role archetypes. And the same goes for the corporates in this meeting. In the parking lot where this guy is getting kicked under the sign for Bushido 3, there's graffiti on the wall that reads, "Where's Johnny?" This could refer to Johnny Silverhand, who was a famous rocker boy and a sample character in the original Cyberpunk. Given the numerous bar minigames in the Witcher series, it seems likely that Cyberpunk 2077 will have billiards. The cowboy leaning on the pool table also makes an appearance in the background earlier in the trailer, so he could be a key character. There's a kid jacked into a VR headset. Will there be video games within this video game? The same goes for robot boxing, which could be a similar system to the fight clubs from the Witcher games. As the camera pulls away from the Augs makeup tutorial, there's a poster on the wall for someone called Lizzie Wizzy, and some newspaper magazine clippings hinting at violence erupting at one of her shows. Pop stars and performers like Lizzie or Johnny Silverhand were often more than just public figures in the cyberpunk world. They'd often find themselves in the middle of conflicts, using their charisma and fame to rally people to their cause. Maybe Cyberpunk will let us recruit our own followers and send them on missions. Night City is sure to have plenty of densely packed urban sprawl, but probably some rural areas too. Who's to say there can't be hillbillies in Cyberpunk? Trauma teams are privately operated paramedic squads, and it's likely that, should we run afoul of some street gangs, we'd be able to pay for their services to tend to any injuries we might have sustained. This poor sap getting his circuits fried on a plane is likely a victim of corporate espionage. There have been at least four full-fledged wars between the megacorporations of Cyberpunk's version of the 21st century, and it's likely that these conflicts will be a big part of the main story of 2077. Jacking into cyberspace plays a major role in cyberpunk fiction, and it'll be interesting to see how it's handled in-game. It'd be a little silly for CD Projekt Red to build a massive open world only to have players roleplay as people staying indoors and going online, but at the very least, expect this game to definitely have some kind of hacking mechanic. Stealing a dude's cybernetic eyeball is pretty gross, but if it's a means of improving your character, that works. And really, cybernetic augmentations go a long way explaining an upgrade system within the story of a video game. Hey, the license plate reads CP77, get it? Once again, a big focus on driving, which seems almost out of place in an RPG, but considering the amount of time spent on horseback in The Witcher 3, it makes perfect sense. How many vehicles will there be? How much customization? We have no idea. This game is still a ways out. But because CD Projekt Red is fully aware of how closely people will be looking at this trailer, they put a nice, handy FAQ in a single frame. It doesn't give a whole lot of hard info, but it reiterates some stuff that we already knew. They'll release the game when it's good and ready, but there's currently no release date. There will be no microtransactions or DRM, and they plan to offer free DLC and expansions like they did with The Witcher. Of course, if you'd like to know more about this universe, there's 30 years worth of lore to dig through from Mike Pondsmith's original Cyberpunk 2020 RPG, but we'll have to wait and see how much of it shows up in 2077. Though hopefully we don't have to wait until the year 2077 to find that out.
Ubisoft came into the show with a lot to prove. Let's see if they pulled it off.
I don't know, up in the balcony, are you guys ready?
No, dobra, taka by była na tyle o Cyberpunku. Właśnie taką analizę trailera, jaką przed chwilą widzieliście, chciałbym zrobić, tylko ja niestety nie znam w ogóle lore. I się właśnie takimi analizami będę posiłkował, żeby zrobić taką analizę po prostu na najwyższym poziomie. Czyżby to już będzie koniec, więcej o Cyberpunku nie będzie. Chyba.
A co jeszcze będzie? Special Features Overcooked.
No to już chyba nic ciekawego. Ale o 2:30 mamy kolejne coś z Cyberpunkiem.
Gdzie?
Na E3 Coliseum.
Wiadomo co?
Słucham?
Wiadomo co?
Na Cyberpunk.
Na coś więcej.
Nie wiadomo, tylko tak niewiele wiadomo.
Dlatego kurwa ja sobie jakoś nie mogę w ogóle opinii wyrobić, no.
A ja po tym co oni teraz powiedzieli po trailerze, po tym jak sobie wyobrażam, to mogę i hype
is real. Bywaj, dobranoc, elo.
Pa, pa. czy było, nie było.
Ja wiem, że sobie podoła ta przestrakę, ale no ja jakby, ja teraz obchodzi to, co będzie w tym roku.
Na mnie nie obchodzi Cyberpunk.
Nie obchodzi Assassin, nie obchodzi Spider-Man.
Znaczy nie mówię, że Assassin mnie też nie obchodzi.
Obchodzi mnie to Rider i obchodzi mnie Red Dead Redemption. Reszta to jest przyszłość. Ja żyję tym, co jest teraz i po wakacjach to... Na Cyberpunka przyjdzie jeszcze czas i miejsce i gra roku, spokojnie.
No.
A jak się daje radę za mocno i gra nie jest prosta naszym wymaganiom, to nie będzie dobrze.
Trudno, ja już jestem zajarany, także już za późno.
No i no i ty jesteś na przegranej pozycji, ja tego jeszcze nie ekscytuję tak mocno. Dad?
Why are you doing this? I love you. Dobra, damy im łapkę w górę, nie będziemy chujami. No dobra, to słuchajcie, póki co chyba będziemy kończyć no. naszego streameła i będziemy się widzieć o 2:30, kiedy tak. będzie... Co będzie?
Będzie
E3 Coliseum.
Coś z cyberpunkiem.
I zobaczymy. I coś z cyberpunkiem. Zobaczymy, co jeszcze powiedzą. No to już było warto, chociażby dlatego oni mniej więcej powiedzieli, co było na tym pokazie ze zamkniętymi drzwiami tak naprawdę. I nie wiem, co jeszcze powiedzą o tej grze. Zobaczymy. Mogliby coś jeszcze pokazać. Już, dobra, nie mówię o gameplayu, bo skoro gameplay był za zamkniętymi drzwiami, to go nie pokażą na pewno. Ale jeszcze jeden trailer? Może? Fajnie by było?
Nie.
Nie. Albo jakiś actual in-game screen. Taki, wiecie, jednolosową klatkę z tego gameplayu. I to już,
a nie.
To już było spoko.
Włączę trailer i tam pisze ładnie i damy footage. Ja wiem, że to może się różnić mocno, ale in-game footage.
No dobra, to słuchajcie, tak jak mówimy. True póki story. Co, to by było na tyle, jeśli chodzi o dzisiaj o cyberpunki.
A co tam się dzieje na IGN?
Nie wiem, coś jest o konferencji Ubisoftu. Ale nie ma o czym. No widzisz, Bartek, kończymy już.
A to jest Sarkiner, dobra, wyjdzie pan.
Tak, bo to jakieś te z tymi figurkami.
Może.
Także to też nas. Na razie kończymy, także Bartek, jeżeli siedzisz dzisiaj, to... Nie, to Bartek, ten Bartek, inny Bartek. Jeżeli siedzisz, to o 2:30, przed 2:30 znowu coś będzie, bo znowu będzie coś o cyberpunku. A na razie kończymy, bo też nie wiem, chyba teraz nic. Znaczy, jest gdzieś tam o 1:00 w nocy coś tam o Falloutie 76, ale aż tak mnie to nie jara, także... Także mówię, no na razie będziemy kończyć. Na razie będziemy kończyć i dopiero jak będzie cyberpunk, to będziemy wracać. Także do tej pory no mam trochę do nauki. To powodzenia tam w tej nauce. Dobra, także do zobaczenia o 2:30.
In my head.